Let's make some bad decisions. I want you.
All right, what's going on, everybody? I am the one, the only, the W-O-O-K-I-E, doing the emergency broadcast for the Q&A. Word on the street, it was tough to hear. It was tough to hear for us, too, because some people know how to talk into a mic, some people don't. So, is what it is. So, I have our resident PhD, Dr. Sheep, here to talk about it with me.
Still stupid.
Yep, Sheep is... grumpy sheep right now, and we decided to bring Miss Sydney along with for the ride too.
Hello,
welcome to the hate zone. This is an all hate all the time network.
And I bring with me my titular segment.
Yeah, your titular segment. Nobody ever gets that joke, and I think it's hilarious. I'm not sure why, but here we are. But we wanted to go over real quick. There was a ton of questions on the Q&A. So just do kind of the real quick. We'll go over some stuff, not everything, because there were some that just, I don't know if they made sense or not, but they did talk. First question was on the banned and restricted list. Is that correct?
Yeah.
I just want to make sure I'm following this correct. So the first question was asking, it was revisions, right?
Yep. Somebody wanted to know if they were considering it using this weekend or not.
And I do believe the answer was that they will be looking it over the next 4 to 6 weeks over the season to determine if any changes needed to be made.
Yep. That's so, all they said.
You're going to hear that phrase quite often throughout this. So
it was their default.
It was basically the easy button that they would push all the time. Next question was vault tours. What... kind of the questioning of the vault tours, where are they going to be? What are they going to do? How are they going to look? And again, we got the, well, we're going to evaluate this season over the next 4 to 6 weeks. And
as much as I was expecting that, I really was hoping for anything a teeny tiny bit more concrete, just because they have already done a whole season. So they already should have some contacts. They also already had a game found. So they already should have that data. Like what information do they need to do more evaluating?
Well, I could see it. Like, do you want to go back to Seattle?
I didn't go the first time.
I know. That's what I'm saying. Like, so I think like there was some that were really successful. There are some that weren't. I think this season was as good as it could have been on extraordinarily short notice. It was super duper thrown together super duper quickly.
Right.
Because originally they had the plan of, I don't want to say expediting, but outsourcing this to a third party. And that didn't happen. And I mean, Sheep, you and I have talked, we still believe that they're going to attempt to outsource this to a third party again. But they kind of got to do it quick.
Yep.
So is that just a grumble? Are you grumbling after everything we say now?
Yeah, no, I agree. I don't think they know what they're doing fully for Vault Tours yet. So we don't get to know.
Yep. So, and they are very much now in the horse or in the stable of, if we don't have a concrete answer, we are not even going to speculate on it. Might have been something we did. Sorry.
It might have something to do with the promises of last year never coming to fruition.
Maybe. Something about that. Next question up was Worlds for the next year. And again, Worlds will be at a very similar time in November at the Game Center again. So I guess we all figured that, but somebody did ask that question. Next question up, crowdfunding. Are they going to continue to crowdfund?
I mean, even though it was only a vague yes, it was basically a yes.
Yes, the answer is they're more than likely going to crowdfund. So from what I got, I was sitting in the back kind of moderating the chat that was going on. And it was, you know, blah, blah, blah. It was a very long-winded answer, but then it was, if it makes sense to do it again, yes, we're going to do it again.
Right, which means they are going to do it again.
Which means, yes, the Ember Skies will also be crowdfunded. Feelings on that one, guys?
I don't personally hate the crowdfunding. I like seeing what I'm getting. I like being able to buy in bulk all at once. And that way, I mean, the extra stuff that they're putting on top is also kind of cool, being able to get the I know your opinions on the posters, but I don't like what it's doing to retail, but I don't hate the crowdfunding aspect of it.
Because we also got a very, I don't want to say short, but a little bit different from last year. Last year, they gave us kind of the whole, like, we're going to have store leader, we're going to have store championships at this date. And those will lead into this, and then that will lead into nationals, and then that, you know, then we're going to have vault tours. None of that was mentioned, and we'll go over more of that this week on Thursday for the episode. But they went more into their idea for store champ, or not store championships, but local play this year. And according to them, 2LO will. So then there was another question with local stores. Next question was, local stores needing required to use the 2LO system? The answer to that was no, but 2LO, for whatever reason, will also have the ability to do Swiss. Not that we use it in the events. Right, Sheep?
Sure.
You're so fiery today, Sheep. Tone it down over there, sir.
Sorry, not 100% focused at the moment.
Gotcha. This one I didn't hear, and this one probably Dark Ascension.
Deck Ascension.
Oh, Deck Ascension. Okay.
Yeah, making decks be no longer playable for whatever reason at whatever level because they've earned the honor to get the heck out of all of the tournaments they're dominating.
Oh, you mean Jacques.
Hey, I didn't say it. You did.
Yeah, Jacques.
You mean Jacques that went 0-2 in Worlds?
It didn't go 0-2, did it?
It went 0-2 in Worlds.
Well.
Isn't that insane? It's so crazy to think that, like, if they take into account what happened at Worlds versus what happened at every single Vault Tour, then Jacques can, in fact, keep, like, winning Vault Tours, taking home money, and getting the invites that other people aren't getting, but then not win the prize at Worlds, so not be ascended.
I mean, Nova won, what, 2 Vault Tours with it?
3?
2 Vault Tours.
2 Vault Tours
and
a National.
Oh, and a Nationals, right.
Nationals, there was no money for. But, I mean, $6,000
got
is $6,000.
Got a sweet mat.
Did get a sweet mat. How many mats did you get this year, Sheep?
I got the same sweet mat. And also, it's twin that says Alliance.
Ah, yes, yes.
Those were my, and then I got ensuite mats.
And we'll talk about those more this Thursday, but I am hoping for some form of deck ascension. I do think it's something that needs to be considered. I do think, Sheep, don't hurt me. Every deck that was in Worlds this year should be ascended to the next level. Let the game move on and move forward.
That may be the dumbest thing I've heard you ever say.
Why?
Because half of those decks, that's the only tournament they've ever even played. I don't know if it's actually half, but some of those decks is basically the only tournament they've ever played in. The deck didn't qualify for Worlds. The player did. It is different things going on there.
That's a struggle, too.
I mean, what they basically ended up saying was they haven't even decided if they're going to do it at all. Like, even though they may be considering doing it in a variety of ways, like, they ended with, if at all. And that's basically, we're giving ourselves an out to not even address this.
That's the feeling you got. That's not the feeling I got.
Ooh, okay.
So just reading a little body language, it's kind of what I do for a living, more or less, running a pawn store. I got the feeling that they are going to make an announcement similar to what I said.
Ooh.
Or in that fashion, and you're going to have a lot of decks that are now just dead, and you're going to have a lot of people.
I think you are high.
Maybe I am. Maybe I am. Maybe I'm not.
I mean, from the read I got, now I wasn't there for the Q&A, but the other people I talked to, the read they got was, Yeah, we ain't gonna do nothing.
That's kind of what I got.
That's not what I got. I got the very uncomfortableness. Hurley was stirring a little bit from what I could see in his chair, meaning they have some idea of how they are going to do it. And I'm not saying it's going to happen now. It may not happen next year. But I do get the feeling they're going to do something, and they're going to do something that is going to irritate a good chunk of the community.
Well, that could be from anything they said.
Ran this event. They already irritated a bunch of community members.
They irritated one person, and that his name is Sheep.
No. I don't actually know if I'm the most.
No, you're not the only one, because literally your situation happened, I think, in every tournament this weekend. Everyone. The Alliance side, I know it happened too.
Yeah.
And I do believe it also happened in the Open. It happened in the Archon Open too. It was literally the same scenario happened. But.
Yep.
Who
needs an update?
So we got into everyone contributes a storyline backstory.
Somebody asked about how they come up with all of the art or all of the storyline. And so the answer was everyone contributes and the artwork informs a lot of the story. So somebody actually cares about the books and the lore.
And then you heard a collective grumble going, this game has a story. I didn't know. I was like, oh, I knew the book was out, but beyond that, I didn't know anything. But
I'm a huge fan. I loved all of it. The books, the lore, the RPG, the flavor text and all the cards. Like I don't need to know how or why, but I appreciate that they do it.
I did see something today from Wizard Random. I don't know if either of you actually have Twitter. but the Noose, what is his name? Tribute something Newsome?
Gavin Newsome?
No, Newsome. Triangulator Newsome.
Triangulator Newsome. He is a card. And on his art is there's an memoriam. And you have there's three characters that are enshrined on there, and it's their card art. No, Comm Officer Palak. So if you look at his card art, there's an in memoriam wall, and there's art for three. It's Kirby, which I think we already knew was Subject Kirby. And then who is the two? If you reap, you gain an ember between who, however many creatures
things
are in between
and
them.
Gross. It's things and draw gross. And gain power.
Thank you. But they're also on the plaque. So rumor on the street is they're dead.
R.I.P.
Yeah. And so is Drummernot.
Does it just have a picture of DT as well?
It's just out of frame.
Side card.
It's just out of frame. Just a little bit to the right. You can't make it out, but big thing I think we are all wondering about as deck ascension story deck customization with the reprints. What was that gonna look like as far as what they were gonna be able to do? And translations, so on and so forth. And when is it gonna be released? So CTP said roughly about 3 to 4 months. And I believe a price point was asked too, and he said under $50. So originally he's like, well, we don't know yet because we don't know. And then it was under $50. So I'm with Sydney, $49.99.
Yeah.
And then I'm not sure if it wasn't right away, was it? Or did somebody ask later on about foils? Oh, yeah, there it is. Foil cards. So it is confirmed they can do foil cards. And maybe... Chin scratcher.
Foil decks, they said,
foil
not
decks,
individual
sorry.
Cards.
Yeah, they can't actually do just cards.
Which makes sense. Like, we've talked about this 100 times. Like, I still don't understand why you can't swap a card for a card. You're doing deck checks anyways. I guess you don't do it at just the base level. Did they do any deck checks besides top 8, Sheep?
They did deck checks for all 64.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, but I'm saying, like, when you went to a vault tour... Right, and you showed up, and you were playing Archon. Did they check your deck to make sure what was there is supposed to be there?
I never noticed them do a in-game deck check, or like
a random
early round.
Yeah,
yeah,
no.
I never noticed one.
I only ever got deck checked at top 8, or top 4. Mm.
And that's the only time I've ever seen them do deck checks is for Worlds. They did everybody. And then, but like usually was always like after cut, they would deck check. So, I mean, I guess if somebody really wants to cheat, they're going to cheat, but whatever.
I like cheating.
You sure do. But yeah, foil decks is something that they said they can't, they have the ability to do, but they didn't realize there's a huge cost to it, which I understand that, you know, 20 sheets of foil paper is somehow $20. So yeah, there's going to be a cost to it. So if you want to foil out your favorite deck, it might be in the $100 price range. That wouldn't surprise me at all. So
one of the things that was significant to me was actually giving a 3 to 4 month time range.
Yes.
When everything else they said was there like 4 to 6 weeks, 4 to 6 weeks, 4, like they actually had a time range for when they could do this, which means to me that they have something in mind that is actually happening.
Well, 4 to 6 weeks.
Yeah. It's 6 to 8 weeks of doing nothing, reviewing and considering the season.
Yep. That was 4 to 6 weeks too. When they said they were going to review the season, they said 4 to 6 weeks.
Right, right. So, but that's why, I mean, it's more meaningful that he actually gave a different timeline for this. 3 to 4 months means that there was a timeline with actual thought behind it. That's different than just the 4 to 6 weeks that they threw out for everything.
Yeah, that's true. That's very true.
I don't know their process well enough to know why it would take 4 to 6 weeks. I mean, 3 to 4 months. Like,
maybe they have to get through printing all the game reminders first.
Well, that's probably one of them. The other one would probably be like
infrastructure for getting all the decks they have to reprint.
Well,
or
but like,
the
how do you enable it? Like, that seems more like so if I'm going to order it, right, and I want to order a deck, where do I put it? Do I put it on the Master Vault site? Do I put it on the
You're saying they need to develop a GG branded storefront because
something
you're not
probably
gonna buy
to
it through Game Center where you gotta buy everything else right
well,
now.
Even if you put it up on do you buy it through Game Center?
That's where you get your Vault Tour tickets.
That's it, like I guess. I don't know.
And literally everything they sell of Keyforge.
Yep. Yeah, all sales currently go through Game Center.
Okay. I mean, but then there's probably like that then has to check with the Master Vault to make sure you own said thing digitally.
Sure.
And then, you know, that's got to talk to another website, which isn't that hard. We have an API for drawbetter.cards. I don't know. It seems like there's actually probably more tech on the back end. And then not only that, so right now they're printing all the Grim Reminders, right? They're printing Grim Reminders. And then they've got to find like a timeline where they're able to do it.
Right.
So like, cause like you can't go into like, well, now we're printing Ember Skies. Stop everything. We got to print this one deck.
Yeah. I don't know how that works functionally at all. What you're saying. Cause like, are you saying what they're going to do is in 2 months, they're going to open up this portal and they're going to be like, all right, if you want a deck reprinted, put it in here. And in 2 more months, we'll shut the printers down from their current jobs to print these decks. Or
well,
is
you
this
said printers. I think they have just the one.
Yep. Gosh. Maybe
they have to print Mindbug. Maybe Mindbug 2 is coming out. And
but
they have a timeline for that.
Are you suggesting that these deck reprints are only going to be available occasionally?
To me, that's kind of the unless they have multiple printers. I mean, are you going to stop everything you're printing right now to print one deck for me and then one deck for you and one deck for Sydney and then one deck for, you know what I mean? Every time you're done, you know, okay, we're printing Grim Reminders today. Hold on. There was an order. We got to stop everything we're doing because I'm sure
paid us $49.99.
Right. So now you got to load probably a completely different software into that system or connect it to something different to then print reprints.
I don't think it's new software. That's not how print drivers work.
Old software, but a different version, because now you're not just importing random decks, you're importing an actual deck.
That's just the computer. The computer needs whatever processing file they use, and then it just sends the print job.
This is why we have two tech people on staff.
Yeah, but they don't ever show up because they're like typical tech people.
Well, one's like 14 years old. Not even finished growing yet.
We don't need to continue being jealous that he has more skills than us at 14.
I mean, does that not make sense? I mean, I guess we can talk more about it on Thursday when we have a Southerly and a Drascor, but...
Both 14.
I don't know.
Well, at least mentally.
Yeah, but I don't know. Like, that, I mean, it seems like you would have to stop everything you're doing, print a deck, and then return back to it.
So also, there's different weight for something like a reprinting of a deck or giving deck borders and the translations of a deck. Because if they end up implementing the fact that you need to have a deck in English or in the language that the Vault Tour is being played in, they are putting a rules requirement on something. So they actually have to be able to let people print that. They need to make the room in their printing schedule for that if they're going to require it.
Right. And I think that's the biggest question. That, to me and my small walnut brain, makes the most sense. But I could be wrong, right? It seems like it's more of a tech thing than anything else.
Sure.
Because I don't know, this company hates money too. So I don't. Let's release a game found, but then not do sealed. Shrug. Next question was on storyline events. So if you did watch the keynote, something will be coming up in summer. For a storyline event, what that means, we have no idea. This company also loves surprises. Even though
I love the fact that we have something like, other than like, they confirmed Worlds will be there next year. So, but nothing between here and Worlds would have been absolutely depressing. But we're walking away with, there will be a thing where I will probably see some of your faces again
six
months from now. Yeah. Right.
Well, no, they said it was a storyline event. And he said it would be somewhere in the summer. So what, June, July, August, somewhere in that time frame? When is Gen Con? Normally that first weekend in August, right?
Oh, yeah.
So probably, I mean, that's at least this year was designated for U.S. Nationals. I don't see why that would change. So probably June or July would be that storyline event. Their answer to it literally was no comment. We don't want to. And I think this is, sometimes it's such a, just a horrible marketing strategy.
I know. To like, not getting us excited for it. Like, why would you do that? You have nothing else for us to be excited for. No event, no physical in-person event for us to be excited for yet next year. And yet the one thing you've teased, you are giving us nothing.
Right. And think about it this way. Like, they teased, like, what did they call this? The Nightfall event where we got Grim Reminders. So we could all kind of make the assumption that we were getting Grim Reminders. But, like, why not put out a placard and be like, be the first to play Grim Reminders at our Nightfall event at Keyforge Celebration in Roseville, Minnesota, 2023. I think you get more people if you put that out there.
Right. The fact that you're giving away the newest set, like my only thing, like, I will give them the benefit of the doubt every time they don't communicate something, in that maybe at the time at which they are communicating, they don't have all the issues ironed out. And it stinks if that is a repeating problem that is causing them to not do all of this advertising, because this is their MO, to not give all the information for something until it is too late to either acquire or be at that something. And it's really, really cool for the people that either jumped in blindly or lucked out and got it.
Well, their MO last year was, let's get everybody excited for this thing that's not going to happen.
Yeah.
And then I think this year they're like, let's maybe not say anything until we know. Also, maybe a consequence of all the shit we gave them for how long? I don't know.
Yeah, I blame you guys for everything.
I would. It's probably our fault, to be honest with you. But, like, it's just, it's one of those things where it's like, this is a perfect opportunity to really market it out there, get us excited for something. I mean, it is what, probably 6 to 10 months away, but like, put it out there. You know, there's going to be a storyline event. We know it's going to be. Where is it going to be? We don't want to say. When is it going to be? We don't want to say. And for a lot of us, it's like, I have to get PTO approved. I have to, you know, there's more to it than just being able to hop on a plane and go. You know, a lot of us have children that we have to figure out plans for them. If
I mean,
we're
half
going.
The people who play KeyForge are teachers, so the summer just was enough for them.
Mm-hmm. But then on the same note, like, some of us aren't teachers, so we got to get PTO approved.
Right.
I like how you're like, a lot of them are teachers. It's literally Z and Z's not a teacher anymore, is he? I don't know. And JR. Who else
is it?
A teacher? I think that's
feels
it
like
now.
Everyone who plays is a teacher.
You know, Tobin's a teacher.
Yes.
He's a professor.
Second act's a teacher.
So out of the 170 people there are three.
Judge guy's a teacher.
G not or Troy. Marcus?
No, Duncan.
Oh, Duncan.
Oh, yeah.
Duncan is a teacher.
There are a lot of teachers in KeyForge.
Sounds like our next marketing opportunity.
But I just, we talk about marketing and we ask the question on that or later. But like, it's like, this is the perfect time to get us excited to see something in the future. Make us, you know, maybe buy a few extra things. And
right?
Just crickets. Then we talked about vault tours, more vault tours overseas. They definitely said that they will be given more time to do it now. Go ahead, sheep.
You know, they tried to outsource them last year. They found two people willing to do it. They're going to try to outsource them again this year. I do expect the information and opportunity to be put out there sooner than it was last year. But I don't know, do they get that much more uptake than they have now? I just don't know.
Gotta break
it could
the
be
wallet.
Time could have been a huge factor where people might have been willing to take them up on whatever their restrictions they needed to meet, but weren't able to get a facility in time or time is what GG can offer them. So
right, it's a money thing. Like it's 100% a money thing.
Sure,
it's got to be right. And you unfortunately with the two formats you've given to people to make money, neither of those actually do. Right, besides for the entry fee, I don't know what kind of anything they would get from the keys. I can't imagine there's any monetary value to the person running it off of the keys that are being spent.
I mean, I guess as time passes, people are going to use up amber shards unless you are, because what is it, 50 shards per key.
Yep.
And so, like, after a while, 50s adds up.
But you're talking, sheep, how many shards you got? A little north of 4 grand.
Sure, that sounds accurate.
Yeah. Oh my gosh.
I'm
down
in like
the 600 something.
Oh, I have
600 something. That's
do you even
you
scan
your
decks?
To open all the no, she doesn't.
She's got all the sleepers just hanging out in her house, so they're not scanned.
Now, I'm now at 3,500 amber shards.
Okay, ooh. I'm at like 3,486. So I mean, those MM days were real, real good to the amber shards, and there may have been a lot bought, but I mean, I don't think either way. I don't think that's a big factor for the tournament organizer to get anything out of it. There's no
the tournament organizer gets absolutely nothing from that key
right.
That's sold.
That's what I'm saying. There's nothing there for them. So outside of the $75 that they would charge for your entry, I guess you could try to sell product, but there's no reason to. Like that was the big thing about sealed, is you're able to make money off of sealed. But I don't. Yeah, do you do the 75 plus? Because it used to just. What was it? Just What happened here? Huh? Well, that was strange. That was totally weird. Did it just kick everyone?
Yes.
I think Sheep pushed a button. I'm pretty sure he just ended the stage. Buttons. He's like, I'm done with this. I'm getting out of here. Maybe we'll see if he comes back. But I don't think, I mean, monetarily, what did it used to be for? It was a $40 for entry for a sealed event? 60?
It depends, because some of them were at conventions and we were able to the prices like literally varied and it was different most events you went to, because like Origins was a $60 to get in.
Because you had to buy the badge with it.
Right, right.
But like when Yeti was running it, Yeti always did it separate from everything else. Did Yeti run it with any conventions? Sheep, what button did you push?
I have no idea what button I pushed, but I'm back.
Yeah, it totally booted all of us. It was the weirdest. I've never seen Discord do that in all the times we've been using it, but that was strange. Oh,
and we're blaming it on me.
My hands are literally on my desk and touching no buttons, so. I don't think Yeti ever did anything in association with a con, because they came in after Gen Con, so there was no cons to run. There was no cons running.
Yeah, I remember the ones I went to with them were run by them.
And they were not all standalone.
Yeah, I'm trying to think. Like, I can't actually come up with one. But I do remember going to them at conventions, like the Origins and Gen Con and the one in Schaumburg.
Yeah, Schaumburg.
And
Schaumburg wasn't Yeti.
Well, yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like, all the ones that I remember were before them.
Yeah, that was all... I don't even remember who that company was anymore. But either way...
Cascade,
yep. So it's like, you gotta... I don't know. Gotta pony up the dough there a little bit. Give them a little bit of sealed so they can try to recoup some money.
Yeah, my favorite thing that they had was a Keyforge vending machine. And I gave way too much money to that vending machine, because the idea of getting a Keyforge deck out of a vending machine was so awesome.
That the FFG vending machine Gen Con? Yeah, that was kind of cool. Too bad it was all AOA.
That didn't even twitch me in the slightest way to say give them money because they put it in a silly vending machine.
It feels so like I'm just going to get a bag of chips, I'm just going to get a drink, and I'll get a Keyforge deck.
They should have put chips and such in there. That would have been like, oh, I'm here already. I might as well. Something to go with my chips and my Pepsi. I'll just grab a Keyforge deck while I'm at it. But that was basically that. Power creep. There was a little talk about power creep because a lot of people think Grim Reminders is busted. Maybe. I don't know. Do you guys feel it's busted?
Nope.
I don't think it's busted, but I don't know. It probably wasn't a slip. Michael probably said this like with clear intention of saying it, but it felt like a slip to me where he specifically said he doesn't think Grim Reminders is more competitive than previous sets. Like, he said that. And so I don't know whether it was to quell the actual question about power creep or if he literally doesn't think it's more competitive. Like as someone who plays competitively, I feel like that doesn't necessarily draw me to the set in a way that where people are afraid of power creep.
I'm all for power creep. The creepier, the better. But like, I think his exact words on that one were, you're correct. He didn't feel like it was more competitive, but it was designed because the old design for all previous sets was to get through your deck as fast as possible. Where the design of Grim Reminders was to get haunted and stay haunted. And that was the set design. Now, whether that ends up being more powerful or not, I don't know. We'll see. I mean, the Geistards definitely feel strong. But I think
I just feel like somebody in MM is going to like put out an auto encoder and have Infernuses in their deck and GG.
It's possible. I don't know. There is a little bit of, I almost called it exile and Sheep was going to yell at me. Purge recursion in there. A little bit. little bit, not a ton, but a little bit. Could be right.
Some of that stuff flips and archives you so fast it may not matter they have Infernus.
It's true. Because there were times I was flipping my deck so quick, you know, before you know it, I'm booing to flip my deck to get back to cards.
Average value of some of those pipped cards is so high that go ahead and purge it. I got more value than your one Infernus pip loss out of the card, and it doesn't matter.
Sure.
That's maybe what happens. I don't know.
Next question up was, if you were given more people and you were in the ability to hire more people, where would you put them? His answer was literally everywhere. But I think he finally settled on graphic design. So they like, I think he said they're using vector imaging.
Bitmap to vector, I thought you guys said.
Yeah, that's what he's, they're all using vector imaging.
I don't know why.
And like, I'm pretty good in MS Paint.
I mean, I think the silver lining is the fact that he would put more resources towards graphic design, and I already actually really like the graphic design, means that like whatever they're currently doing is good enough for me, and whatever struggles they're having behind the scenes are not showing.
I think the struggle is that digital assets, especially new ones, take a long time to do. They just do, no matter what way you slice it.
Sure.
And, you know, we've heard Josh talk about it, you know, working with such and such to get digital assets, so on and so forth. It's just digital assets and anything in graphic design is always a pain and it always takes forever. I don't know why. It's 2023. You think we'd be further along than we are, but we're not. And it always takes forever. So I understood that, at least. I don't know why they went from bitmapping to vector. As far as I understand it, now I'm not a graphic designer in any which way you can slice anything. I don't know much about it. But I always thought bitmap went faster than vector imaging. And we never had a problem before, really, with the images. So why go from bitmap to vector? Because as far as I knew, vector would take longer than bitmap does.
Doesn't vector has something to do with,
I thought it was more high fidelity.
I think it probably print renders faster, because I know I could only send vector to any of my print related places. Like, you send them anything else and they're like, it's vector. And Josh is saying something about scalability.
Oh yeah, they did mention that on stage, where like if they wanted to make it bigger, it actually looked real bad.
Yeah. Well, if it's in bitmapping. So you have
to change it from bitmap to vector
to scale it, but okay. Again, I don't know.
This is real boring stuff.
Control
boring.
F. Hold on. Control F and Photoshop. I'll take care of it for you. Rasterize the layer and you're done. All right. Digital client. It will not be coming to a store near you.
Thank you, TCO.
Bitmaps are rasterized. Thank you. TCO is still is available to you, and CTP loves them.
Yeah.
As far as we know.
Yay, free work.
Yeah. So there is aspirations, but not probably.
There's probably a lot of ass going on.
A lot of ass.
Yeah, that was like straight up denied. And I like that he specifically talked about TCO, like didn't even, because the way the question was asked didn't mention it, said digital client. And then the way that the answer was said, like, he straight up said the Crucible Online. There was no hiding how much he appreciated that exists.
Just play on TCO.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. The next question was out of the freaking Drazcore. I give him a list of questions and leave it to him to go off the charts. His next Drazcore, and I'm going to blame this one on him, is what menagerie packets didn't make it to fruition? Somehow Hastasis Raptor made it.
And Plague Rats.
Did Plague Rats make it?
Yes.
I didn't see any Plague Rats.
Stupid Exploiters.
Yeah, and the Anomaly Exploiters.
Precision Exploiters.
I also don't know who decided that Shadow's Weapons was a good idea.
Hey, that's a fun one.
It is not.
I don't know why you dislike that one. It's because you're bad at this game.
It's all artifacts, sheep. It's all artifacts.
It's all
of it.
Timeable artifacts to kill creatures effectively when you need it most.
But
this
then
is
you,
good stuff.
But then you have no creatures to do anything with, sheep.
I like the key frog one because it brings in, like, it mavericks in a ton of things that can kill key frog on turn.
But one of the packets that did not make it, Jargoogle. Don't know what would have been in a Jargoogle menagerie packet.
A headache. But that's what would have been in a Jargoogle.
It would have been Sydney's alliance deck.
Yes, exactly. The thing that ruled against me at Philadelphia because a judge call went a different way than what I thought it. Something to confuse new players. Totally.
Yay. Confusing new players is the best. All right. There was something about new prizes, or was that for the kits?
No new prizes to reveal. That's something that surprised me. They had nothing new to reveal, even though what was asked is like along the lines of what you're going to send out, what's going to be available. And so basically we can expect to see what so far we can expect to see what we've already seen. So nothing outside of what's
Listen,
been.
Those backpacks were pretty sweet. I enjoy the I know it's a stupid string backpack, but I was like, this is kind of cool. I enjoy this. Now, how long I enjoy it for is another story, but I enjoyed it, at least for the time being.
I wouldn't have believed him if they said there was a chair.
I said the chair. And that one guy is like, yeah, I was supposed to get a chair.
Yeah, give me a chair. And then CTP's like, just go across the way.
Asmodee is literally across the street.
Go knock on their door.
I'm like, weird. I also did not receive
a
chair.
Is it a question asked later about the prize wall, or was it during this question?
I think it was during this question.
Yes, I do think it was during this question.
Because we got the prize wall back. Josh did a good job of putting something together for people to spend their tickets on that we got.
I think
it was pretty successful.
I really loved it. It was actually something aspirational to do the whole time. Like, literally, if you were one or two tickets short, you just went to play one or two more games to get those tickets.
Right.
Or what was also really nice is people, because it was physical and in our hand, unlike when people have like they're a couple of Amber Shards in the app short and they can't give it to someone else or share it with someone else. And the old prize wall, like I was able to give Blake one of my tickets so that he could get a prize that he had been working towards the whole time. It was, I really, really liked it.
Yeah, that was nice. So, I'm not going to go through that one. It was basically a question on how they determine what houses come in, what houses leave. And it was basically synergies.
There will be four sets in a row with a new house.
Geistoid, Equidon, Geistoid.
Unfathomable, Equidon.
Oh, yeah. I just forgot about it.
And
DT's
then
not a real
Amber's
set. But
it's
yes.
Just that rate of, oh, hey.
Ah, it's Dryscore. Hi, Dryscore.
Let's go, guys.
We're just talking about how this is all your fault and your dumb question.
We just went through
Jargoogle.
Oh, yeah. That was a great question.
That was a horrible question. I give you a list of questions, and you're like, hey, what packet didn't make it?
Well, hold on. Actually, you didn't give me a list of questions.
They were sent to you into the docs.
Nope. Nope, nope, nope. Z had to share them with me. And then you were like, that's not the right list. And so I'm like, well, this is the list I got.
Yeah, I don't know what list.
Sounds about as professional as you guys get.
Hard-hitting journalism there.
Yep. So then I went and added some questions, some from our lovely audience posting online, some genius questions that I came up with myself.
Mm-hmm.
He was a little sleep deprived.
Yeah,
jet lagged.
All of it.
There was some lagging of the jet. This is true. I definitely, by Sunday night I was fine, but definitely on Friday I was pretty out of it.
Sunday I took a 5-hour nap in the car.
Whoa,
it was good.
Well, night. We talked about all of
yeah,
this.
Yeah, you did.
Yeah. 5 hours. But foil cards. Another question was asked: is there going to be foil cards? We kind of went through it already. It'll be foil decks if there are foil decks. Something I am excited for is foil decks. I really hope they don't cost me $1 million, but if they do, maybe I do it.
Maybe
that was pretty cool that they said that that was a thing that they could do. Now, they didn't say they will do it, but they said they could.
To know they can do it, and then he's like, maybe that's something we offer when we do deck when we do the deck printings. And I was like, yes, please. I stood up in the back. I was like, oh, foils?
I mean, it's going to turn that $49.90. Like, if you need to like reprint a deck, you want to give it a border or make it foil, and you need it translated, that's like a $300 transaction right there.
Well, the translation would probably be the most expensive, would be my assumption.
I would think, because if it's in the rules that it, they would be requiring of it, it might be the least.
But it's the most expensive thing to do.
I'm going to ask for mine to be translated into Pig Latin.
Fantastic. I'm sure there won't. I'm 100% sure there won't be a drop down and they're going to allow you to just type in what language Latin you want it in.
Come on. Come on. I'm gonna ping Sky Jedi and be like, dude, this is what we need.
Check this out.
Especially
think about it.
Some of those cards with text that like are like a block of text. You got to get the language that's the like longest possible language.
Yeah,
that definitely won't be a pain in the ass at Vault Tours. Not one bit. All right. Future of the Master Vault. Small fixes and then normal upkeep. I don't really understand what the question was when they were saying what was the future.
Somebody
of the
asked
Master
what
Vault.
Else they were going to do with it, like what they're working on, what we should look forward to. And basically, like how they plan on like expanding it in the future. And he said, like, right now we're fixing small bugs and we're doing normal upkeep. And so we're making it so that it was not as like, so behind the scenes stuff, like their focus right now is behind the scenes stuff, not
upkeep.
New features. Yeah.
Normal upkeep. I don't really know what we were hoping for more out of the Master Vault. Anybody got anything? Nope.
My thought with what that question was.
Search?
Yeah, quality search, like deck management features, right? Like, but honestly, DOK does so much right now that I don't know that they're incentivized to go and do a huge amount.
Yeah.
I think one thing that they also mentioned this in the keynote earlier, but part of what used to be available to us in the app was like events. Like we used to be able to
find finders. Finders. Yeah.
Before just being played.
Yeah, that was one of the things that they've been hinting about, right? Like, Josh had previously hinted about that. Now that question wasn't directly asked in the Q&A.
There was a question about will there be an app again?
Yeah.
And the answer was basically no. Like,
because it's
web-based, and that's fine.
Yeah, there's a lot of duplicate development. Or you have to use one of the programs that, you know, generate a crappy version of multiple things, right? Which can work. But so I think it totally makes sense to say, hey, we're a small company, just do web, even if it's not perfect, do that.
This one confused me. I was actually talking to Jason about this one. I was like, what does this mean? What does this mean? Somebody asked a question about procedurally generated multicolor backs. So the back of your Archon card.
I was confused. Like when it was asked, I was like, are you looking for like being able to pick three colors that are mixed? Are you looking for a rainbow? Are you looking for like, I was not understanding.
I just, when that was asked, I looked at Jason, like, what does that mean? He's like, I don't know.
Because isn't it already? It's already procedurally generated. Like, what more do you want?
More than one color.
Just more than one color? A gradient?
I thought it was hilarious that almost every single member of the, like, every single person sitting on stage had to answer this question. And that, like, CTP was just like, yeah, sure.
Yeah, and you saw everyone else.
Yeah,
go,
yeah.
Oh, else no. Like, you saw four discuss and one go, I guess we could do that. And everyone else just went, no. I guess there's seven possible colors. I never cared enough to add them up. But I guess there's seven possible colors right now. You don't see the back of your cards anyways, like, ever. Yeah, especially not in high-level play.
Anything other than, you know, ridiculously easy, the value I don't think is there, you know, across the game to do that. You know, obviously this one person thought it was cool enough to ask the question, but hey, if they're prioritizing things, I doubt this is.
You want to know what? If you gave me cards with no art on them and the backs were just white, I'd be fine. Go all to one back.
No, that's lame.
No, that's not. It's just you don't.
Yeah, it is lame.
Do you really look at the back of your cards ever and be like, oh, that's cool? Like maybe once.
Sometimes.
Hey, if they made pink ones, I would go for pink ones.
That's fine. Let's just put the Keyforge logo on the back and call it a day. Everything has the same back.
No.
Easy peasy.
No.
Why?
Wookie, I'll go fire you.
Why?
Come on, this is one of the coolest things.
They're already doing
something
cool, and you want to take it away?
Outside of actual competitive decks, I don't sleep a damn thing because it's fun having. Like, those menagerie decks look cool. It sucks that we have to sleeve them.
Because it's fun watching people cringe as they look at you, like, trying to, like, shuffle and nicking sides. And
mm-hmm. I'll tell you what. Great, just rough shuffling stuff and people being like,
I don't know. The back of the card doesn't mean as much to me as I guess it does to you guys. So we'll keep the backs for now, I suppose. Here's the marketing.
The cards don't mean much to you either.
Huh?
The front of the cards don't mean much to you either.
No, they just need to be good. Stop giving me all the crappy ones.
Stop saying you like Pester Grove.
I do like Pester Grove. And Heart of the Forest.
This is your fault.
There's a problem.
Stop saying these, Wookiee. They listen to you.
I like cards that make my opponent's life bad. That's why the curses are here.
Oh man, there's not a Pester Grove pack in Menagerie, is there?
No, but Pester Grove, I believe, is in Grim Reminders.
Is it really?
Okay. Along with Dark Heart of the Forest.
No.
Which does what Heart of the Forest, it's a worse Heart of the Forest. It does what Heart of the Forest does, but only when you're haunted.
Duh.
So, there's that. All right, so Mr. Ewok finally came up and asked his marketing question. I was actually surprised this wasn't his first question. But basically, I'm asking what is the strategies going to be going forward in marketing? This is the one answer I felt like it wasn't an acceptable answer. This is the one area where I felt like this type of marketing doesn't work. So it was it's targeted marketing on things like Facebook, going to Gamma and Gen Con. Trying to get more lapsed players and getting into the game bars.
Because when he was talking about it during the keynote earlier, like what CTP said when he was giving his presentation had to do a lot with wanting to become reliable so that people actually start trusting them. So after a year of having sets come out on a regular schedule, actually having and running events, having this Worlds event, having over a year of a history, like a lot of things, like literally a lot of things in life take into account how long you've been running something well. And I drank the Kool-Aid when he said that, because that actually makes so much sense to me that that's something they can present to whatever, whoever they're trying to present a backstory to about why you should carry or buy or play Keyforge.
See, and I think the problem there is that's all fine and dandy, but you're not distributing your product.
Yeah.
Asmodee is distributing your product outside of the game zone.
If they bother.
Right.
So I think part of what Sydney's getting at, which I think is interesting, is so if I put on my, you know, business or corporate whatever hat for a moment, so Sydney's referring to something that actually was kind of an answer to the question, whereas unfortunately, Jeremy, you said a bunch of things, but that didn't really answer the question. You named a bunch of activities as opposed to talk to the strategy, right? Mm-hmm. Those activities may well be good, hopefully, but I do think Ewok was in particular poking at strategy because it's a question of, okay, what are the principles? What are the main tenets of the things you're going to try to follow, and then you're going to the various individual actions, right? Can can change over time based on what you learn, based on what does or doesn't work.
Now, I want to say one thing, because to be fair to Jeremy, Ewok did not use the word strategy. And he did not. And that was the one thing where I kind of wanted to poke him, and I wasn't close enough to do it. It'd be like, hey, you need to talk about what is their strategy.
Well, what did he say? Because I definitely felt like the answer was so-so as it was coming out, right?
For his question, it was still a so-so answer, right? Because it was like, how are you going to market, you know, the game being back and get it into retail stores and get the hype back up, so on and so forth. But he never actually used the word strategy. And I'm like, you need to add, because that's an important word.
I thought he did. Or maybe I was just reading what we have in our notes, which used the word strategy. So yes. I thought he said it. Maybe that's possible.
Because I planted that word with him in the car ride. I'm like, you need, and I told him specifically, and maybe he did, but I remember him not using it. And I was like, you have to use the word strategy, because otherwise you're going to get
bullshit.
All right,
we have 9 members in our audience. Everybody tell us, did Ewok say strategy or not?
Go ahead,
type that in the notes.
But so, we'll find out. But go ahead, keep going.
But anywho, so I think Sydney's getting at part of it, though. What is the strategy? I think part one is what you just said, right? It's the trying to build that confidence, try to build that track record, right? So that's part of your strategy, is saying, hey, that you can trust us. Now, when, you know, let's get away from, hey, have they accomplished this so far or not? But anywho, that could be part of their strategy, and that makes some sense, I think. And it is a little tricky, right? Because, like, honestly, what was underneath, I think, a bit of what Jeremy was saying was that part of their strategy is to not spend that much money on marketing, right? And that wasn't even subtle. Okay. So now maybe you feel like, hey, I shouldn't use those words in front of these groups of folks. I guess if I was a member of GG, I'd have to think about if I actually wanted to say it that way. But it's probably a correct strategy for them, right? Because you can burn a lot of money on marketing. You gotta really figure out what would work first, right? Now, we've given a lot of suggestions on the show of some other ways they might be able, some other avenues they might be able to go after. Haven't really looked up how much these might actually cost, right? We don't know how much William Dafoe wants.
He wants a bucket of money, Peter.
Yeah, or what the P-Hub charges these days. We don't know, right? But you know, these are some interesting suggestions, right? Half joke, half
do not follow real. Our strategy. Well, no, do not follow
you know, in terms of hey, where is your audience at, or where's your potential audience, and what are they doing, right? Cheap. I think you mentioned the DIY home improvement YouTube stuff, right? Like, that actually might be the perfect place, right? I don't know how much that costs. Truly, but hey, you could maybe try in small amounts and see if that works. So you could, through some of these other mechanisms, still hold to that strategy of, hey, I don't want to spend that much money here. So I don't know. Like, it would have been nice.
It always seems like every time we talk to them, there's no budget for it.
Well, there's not.
Like, where, right? Well, and right, there's no budget for OP. There's no budget for marketing.
Well, the budget is they hired a marketing guy and they hired an OP guy. They have to live somewhere. And, you know, they broke out of the cages that CTP had them in the offices. And so they actually have to live somewhere. Right. So, so, I mean, humans are not cheap to employ. So you know, I and their revenue is, you know, not yet what they dream of it being. So they do have to be a little cautious. But I would have liked to have heard it, heard them say, here's the high level things we're trying to do. And then, hey, here's some examples where, you know, hey, some of those things Jeremy mentioned could be examples of those things. I think that would have driven a lot more confidence. for me, as opposed to what I took away, was more of like, well, we're trying lots of cheap things that probably won't work, right?
That's what I heard. I don't know. Mm-hmm. Like, wasn't expressly stated that way, but like,
going to Gamma,
and just purely... I don't know how much traffic and revenue.
It felt like a summary to me, because if you think about it, he said going to Gamma to talk to retailers. Retailers, check. Doing a Facebook page for retailers, and then continuing to reach out to new lapsed players. And then I was talking, one of them was about distributors. Gamma maybe also, they mentioned distributors. They were checking off a list of all the different people, or the categories of people that it's important to get the word out about KeyForge to. So that was, it was more like a checklist than anything else.
And again, right. we use that word lapsed player. I think it's like, okay, we've move on. Get some fresh blood in here. Like, they're lapsed. They're lapsed for a reason. They're not checking their email from Ghost Galaxy, right? Like, we need to get some fresh blood in here. So you need to get people excited to move forward and get new people into this game moving forward, as opposed to continuing to try to cater to a group that has left your game once already.
What they're secretly meaning by lapsed player isn't the person who independently came to a game store and will now start coming to a game store again. The lapsed player is the person who is the best friend of the person who still plays and doesn't play anymore. And if they can get that person to come back, then they have a person that they know that's already playing, and it's just a short hop, skip, and a jump, and not like a leap across a pond. So lapsed player is definitely a, I think, they're trying to reach the easier to get lapsed players and not necessarily dive deep into the people that have way given up on the game.
I want to know where this list of lapsed players is. Is there a list somewhere I can get?
Well, they should have it, right? They have the Master Vault, right?
Yeah. I can list you some podcasts that no longer exist.
Yeah. So I think what they should do is, right? Jeremy's their marketing guy, right? So he is their marketing budget. He should just... dress in black, sneak into game stores, cut open the Lorcana decks, shove a KeyForge deck inside, and then use the patented Archon's Corners resealing glue to seal that bad boy back up.
There's no budget for resealing glue. I think you missed that. There's no budget for the resealing glue, so.
We've got pallets, so we'll give GG a good discount. Yep.
You know? It was so profitable for the LCQ, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Oh, I don't want to talk about it.
Yeah.
I pulled no fire. Not a one. Then we went into keys being required for new players, which I don't know if this was a international player that asked the question.
Yes.
And I don't think they understood quite what they meant. Like, there's no, for everything like Vault Tour Nationals and lower, there's no key requirement.
I think premieres are the
premier level play is the only
nationals and above.
Right.
Yeah. So I don't know if that was quite understood, or if that even what was the question was. But I do think there was a bigger portion, and we're running out of time here because people got to go. But there was a good, not so much question, but statement on the 2LO.
Would you call that good?
I liked it.
Go ahead.
I thought it was very good. I don't know the player that said it. So if any of you do, let me know. But basically the fact of hidden brackets, 2LOs, the worst thing you can do to a new player that comes to a major event is tell them after two losses they're no longer able to play. Hidden brackets, things getting broken, and just ultimately a system that doesn't work for this game. Now, they might iron out a few more things, but ultimately a system that just doesn't end up working.
Can I, like, shut that down? Because if you are a local store and on your regular weekly events you have some new players, don't do 2LO. Like, play what we do at our store. Like, we pick our opponent we haven't played yet. We aren't in any system to currently play with our six people. Like, I just, they even said earlier in the questions that you don't need 2LO.
I think more of it was focused on the higher end event, right? Because if I'm a new player, I mean, let's be honest, we've all been in that position where we're like, we're good at this game, and then we go to our we spend a lot of money to go to a high level event, a premier event, right? We get raffle stomped, and right now with the current system, you 2 losses, you're done. You're hitting the bricks, right? So if
second
you are
amber exists,
it does exist.
That big of a problem. It's only a problem because people are making it a problem.
I think it is a problem.
Yeah, it's just
no.
Like,
you
look,
just go and say I'm playing second amber now, and they go, okay, go play right there. I think it would be nice for them to get second amber finally built into playstyle, so you just find your match just like you do for every other game, and then you almost wouldn't even know you weren't in the main event because you're still playing the same people there with the same decks they brought.
Yep.
And yes, it just doesn't matter to that, the main tournament.
That
right?
would like, make that, it better because then you just get moved from one bracket to the other. And you're still paired with a person. You're still playing.
Yeah.
Yes.
Still playing on the same time slot, so you go to break at the same time, right, and time is called and your game ends, and you're not like sitting there going like, games have been going on for like 75 minutes and nobody's going to end it for us.
Right, right. I think the, the current system's not perfect. I think the suggestions you guys just made, those are good suggestions. I don't know. I did think it was interesting, right? I thought the it was a little over the top. I thought the sort of the emphasis who's placing now, you know,
I do think they need to sit down and take a good, long, hard look at Tuello. Right? It did what it needed to do for the season, but it could be done better.
They need to fix Tuello and buys.
Mm-hmm.
Well, yeah, I think they promised. Yeah, what they gave those buys out when they thought they were doing double elimination, right? So,
yeah, it is very different. Buys in that giant double elimination bracket works out way, way different than buys and destroying a 2LO bracket.
Right. Yeah. So I'll give him a pass or, you know, a mulligan on that because 2LO is better than.
Yeah, this is really the Thursday show where we firebomb this. We got to finish talking about what they talked about.
Yeah.
Well, now, that's the last of the questions. So.
Yeah, well, the one final thing I'll say about this that I thought was super interesting was, right, so GG, right, didn't answer. And, like, nobody had to say or do anything. Like, everybody knew what to do. Like, hand the mic to the next person, pretend like the question wasn't even asked. Nobody blinked on stage. Keep going, right? That was interesting, right? Means they all talked about this. Like, hey, if we get a question like this about this, ignore.
Didn't I hear they he covered the mic on Josh right there at the beginning and didn't let him talk?
There was a question that was about OP or Vault Tours the room erupted in laughter when he put his hand on the phone and started whispering into Josh's ear because the mic was handed to Josh.
That was Ewok's. That was a show. I think that was a show because it was Ewok's question. He's wearing the AC shirt. Right. I thought that was more of like a, hey, we know who this is. We're going to play
the
game.
Yeah, but he's the nice one.
Yeah, I mean, that's why we put him up
there. No, he's not.
That's my read.
Wow. that's why we put him in that position.
He's not here to defend himself. Nice.
My read of that situation was that, you know, Josh was told not to say certain things. So he looks at DTP like, can I say something? And then CTP sort of whispers in his ear.
No.
Yeah.
Like, shut your mouth.
Yeah, you can't talk about XYZ. If you want to say something about ABC, go ahead. That was sort of my read. And then Josh decided, ABC has nothing to do with the question. So
yeah,
not really going to go there. That I don't know, right? That was my read.
Yeah, Fig, it only has 3 befuddles, so he's not a monster.
Yeah, he's just a demon.
I mean, maybe he cycled. I don't know. And played a 4th. I guess it's possible. Not Ewok style to make it all the way through a deck, but, you know.
Not in 45 minutes.
No, sir. I thought it was kind of like a four show, and I think that's why everybody laughed, because everybody knew who was up there asking the question.
Yes. Yeah.
And then I thought it was kind of like a little show play around, you know, thing.
Because it was also like the mic was confidently handed over to Josh. So like, I'm pretty sure everyone on that stage knew he could handle the question. And that's why it was funny that Christian did what he did.
Yeah. So I don't know. Maybe there was something more malicious there. I really didn't get that vibe. But my person meter, whatever, is broken sometimes. So.
Was
there anything in particular?
Your empathy? Is that what you're talking
about?
Not
empathy. That is also something I lacked. But my, you know, what do you call that? My person's trust meter? I don't know. I'm still tired. I have not slept well.
Yeah, I got an all-time low trust-o-meter going on these days.
That's a Thursday show thing. But that was all for our questions that went through. Did we miss anything? Anybody?
I want to know if there's anything, is there anything you guys are super, super surprised wasn't asked, or anything you wanted to get to? Cause there were a couple of things. I was surprised nobody asked why the flumph. I really wanted to know why they picked flumph instead of, you know, anything else.
We
say it's cause they already had it in had already been designed.
FFG had already designed it. It just came in the pile of things with it. They called the company that was, you know, offered to make it.
Like the cuts ready.
Right. And they're like, how much? And they're like, this much. And they're like, okay, let's do it.
Yep.
Very minimal effort.
Development work was already paid for.
That's right. So
you notice they did not mention plushies as part of their marketing strategy. So probably not investing that much time there.
Start putting them in claw machines.
Well, I mean, what are we getting at? If they're not doing any new prizes, are we just going to stick in this FFG prize vault where we're going to get the same four deck boxes and the same three mats we've been getting for 2 years?
Well, my question is, because the deck boxes and the mat you got for Menagerie, like, how many grand championships did FFG think they were going to run?
Good for them for thinking a lot.
Like, they thought, they're like, man, grand championships are going to be everywhere, and there's going to be a lot of, because they were all date stamped. They all said 2019 on them.
Well, you got to think, those, they actually ordered quantities of OP based off of COTA sales, which were very, very, very good. And then nothing really ran until AOA. And that was not very, very, very good anymore.
Right.
I mean, people were going for those things on the prize wall that, like, I have five copies of. People were spending their tickets to get those things.
I was literally I'm like, I don't care about this ticket. You may have it. Like, win, lose, or draw, it does not matter to me. There's nothing on that wall that I don't already own except for a Unchained pin. And Ewok's like, I have like 15 of them. You can have one. Like, okay, fine. So like
three,
whatever. He said I could have one. It's fine. The only other thing that might have tickled my pickle was the Vault Master,
the
sleeves. The what?
Oh,
the DT decks.
There were DT decks out there.
Yeah, they had.
You guys are blind.
How many tickets were the DT decks? I didn't even ask.
12.
DT decks are going to, like, outlive the apocalypse. There's going to be, like cockroaches and DT decks left on the planet when the world goes to crap.
And AOA decks. There will always be more AOA decks.
Yeah, AOA decks are everywhere. AOA and DT. I should buy more AOA. Maybe I shouldn't. We did have a question in here about sealed being an option in 2024. We didn't get to ask. We also wanted to ask about the Vault Tour.
Oh, no, that was asked.
Was it?
Yeah, that was definitely asked. And they said, we'll think about it.
It was part of the
Vault Tours.
Can't say, won't.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Share.
I don't remember him asking it, but we did want to talk about the outsourcing of the Vault Tours, if that was something they were looking into.
Oh, that is an interesting stat, Josh just put there. That they actually went through quite a few DT, but nobody took an Unchained deck.
Oh, interesting.
Because they could get Menagerie. They were at the place where they could get Menagerie.
Yeah.
Although I did see Onchained getting played over the weekend. I saw Onchained decks playing.
Interesting.
Like two cockroaches in the corner.
Black and white ones.
Yeah, two cockroaches in the corner.
Oh, maybe they were playing adaptive with it.
Ugh.
Oof.
Can we just forget adaptive was ever a thing and never bring it up again?
No.
Like...
It's my favorite.
People who like
it's one of my favorite things to pick on.
Well, I am so tired of hearing about adaptive. Like, oh, it's the most way you should be playing it. Blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, hey, yeah, man, adaptive is going to live as long as reversal and shredder.
Sith is saying some people love adaptive. Yes, there are about seven of them. The same number that actually play Legacy in.
There's a whole league that does.
Yeah, adaptive. And there are seven of them.
No, there's actually like 40 Coggy. Or something.
Yeah,
here.
It's
people like it.
If we were supposed to play the game as Garfield intended it, unban library access, redo bait and switch. let's go back to when I could lock you out of the game with a Rusty and a Control of the Week. Let's do that.
That's for Unchained.
Well, no, it can't be because of the way the cards are written now and the rules are written. You can't do that.
Yeah, but those aren't legal anyway.
Right. So it's not. I mean, yeah, if I want to play at my kitchen table any way I want, I just flip three keys like that one guy did to me in TCO. Just did /forge/forge/forge/forge and won. Right. I'm just, you know.
Was that was it Ewok on a secondary account?
No, this is some time ago where like the guy was like bitching at me because I was playing too slow. And I'm like, really, bruh? Like I am.
It was definitely Ewok.
I am playing at a brisk. Ewok. I'm playing at a brisk
it's
pace.
Slow walk and slow wook. They both show up sometimes.
We're actually the same person, just two sides of the same coin. Mm. He's the happy one. I'm just always angry. That's all it is. But Sheep's got enough piss and vinegar for the both of us these past few days. So there was... That was asked. We also Z did want to, and he never did. I don't know why. We wanted to know what is the next game, next non Keyforge, non Mind Bug game they will be producing.
Who cares?
Well, having an answer would have told us a lot. Like if they had an answer,
I think if they were like, oh, it's gonna be this game, we're like, that makes sense.
Like, you know, they confidently had something else that was going to be taking off their printers.
Right, which they have one of, by the way. But, like, I told him, I'm like, you're not going to get an answer. It's a waste of a question. They're not going to be able to tell you what else they're producing for some other
You don't think
company.
They'd be proud of it? You don't think they would want you to go buy it right there in the game center?
If they're the producer of it, yes. But I think, because like Mindbug's not a GG game, correct? That's another company that they just produce the product.
They have a distribution agreement on that one.
Right.
Which means they are producing it, marketing it, and selling it in the States. I believe that's what the deal with that one is. It is not just a thing. They are also a contract printer, not GG, Artiforge.
Right.
And maybe to some extent, ForgeFire is doing work too. But Artiforge is a contract printer for other companies where you will not know what they're doing because they run a print run and they ship it to them and they repack it, or they do if they're doing final packs, or they might be printing like in board games, they might be doing prints of decks of cards that then go to the next place and they all get boxed together with a board game. Like they can do that kind of stuff there too.
Right.
So Artiforge is definitely probably printing stuff that has nothing to do with Ghost Galaxy.
Correct.
I think. Well, we don't know.
It makes sense. Like, what do you do between sets?
I mean, it depends how slow your printer is. Maybe you're just still printing the set.
I don't know, man. Unless that footage was sped up. Like, it seems to be printing at a pretty good pace.
I do, you know, they showed all those... Grim Reminders boxes. I do sort of wonder if you know, because they did, right? They didn't, to Cindy's point, they didn't say it in the strategy section, but they sort of said their strategy in a separate part of the presentation for marketing. Like, do you think they're maybe going to try to get these things out there to backers, like, ultra fast, like, as soon as the thing closes, start shipping? It's possible.
It is possible.
I think stuff starts shipping right after the holiday.
That could be.
They also need to collect so much information.
Well, the game farm's closed.
Starting 2 days from now, we got to put it in, right?
Right.
It's like real soon.
Oh, yeah.
So, I mean, maybe you get it by January. Who knows? I don't. I'm not in charge of
we
that
don't.
Portion.
We don't. And plus, it will take a bit because they're going to ship international first, which I think is a wise move on their part.
Well,
yeah, the pledge manager closes on the 27th of November. So,
yeah.
Oh, it's like two weeks.
Two-ish.
That's right after Thanksgiving. Is that right after? Well, it is after Thanksgiving, but.
Yeah, well, you know.
That's that Monday.
When you're at the Thanksgiving table, you can say.
I got to clean out my
for encouraging your the pledge manager.
No, when you get bored because your family's fighting and I'm on my phone and I have to, oh, yeah, that's right. I have to fill out my pledge manager. I can do it on my phone while my family's arguing.
Who does that? I just there kick them out.
I would think you would just join in.
You're in my house.
Yeah, we thought you
what
were the one
causing
fighting.
Problems. Yeah.
No, I haven't talked to my mother-in-law in 3 years.
Oh, well, lovely.
Yeah,
great way to, you know, recap this.
Yeah, why not? So, if you don't like someone, just don't talk to them. No. But anyway, that's going to do it for us. Wanted to get this out to you guys just so you guys, because I know it was hard to understand. They also were having a bucket of mic issues, like, from beginning to end. I don't know what's wrong with their microphones. Like, maybe it's time for new ones, but no budget for that, so we'll have to just keep
comes out of the marketing budget, so
we'll just have to keep using the, because they had the same problems last year too, by the way, with the damn microphone, and it's like, buy new microphones. That one's clearly not working. But that's gonna do it for us this week. We'll see you all on Thursday. Bye bye.
Happy Thorgin, everyone. All of the time. So give me all your kisses. I want you Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, baby, every night. And it feels like, I can see we'll ever get you out of my mind. And it feels like, say what? I want you all of the time.